I have here a pipe of sorts. I blow in air here, and the air current comes out through the spout. Just so that you are convinced the air is coming out, watch. The air is coming out. Okay. Now, I'm going to put this very light ball just above the spout, okay, and blow on it. The upward streaming air is supporting the weight of the ball so that it's in levitation, it's floating in the middle of the air. So far, so good. But now, I can support it completely off the vertical. Let's see if I can do it in the other direction too. Did you see that while it's off the vertical, the ball is spinning? This phenomenon has to do with all sorts of questions, a whole range of questions that are often discussed in popular literature and technical literature, and has to do with, for example, how a plane flies. Now, the usual explanation is that it's Bernoulli's theorem. That's the technical term that people always invoke. And it's supposed to say that if you have a flow of fluid, air, water, what have you, the sum of density times velocity squared over 2, so speed squared, plus the pressure is supposed to be constant. So if there's a large speed, there's small pressure, and if there's a large pressure, there's small speed. And they'll have you believe that, well, there's fast airflow on this side, and there's slow airflow on this side, so the fast side has a low pressure, and the slow side has a high pressure, so the high pressure region is pushing the low pressure region, and so it's going to be lifted in this direction, fighting the gravitational fall. And they will say that that's the same thing why the airplane is flying. Now, this is not quite right, because Bernoulli's theorem, if you read the actual proof and the statement and so on, says that for each streamline, that is the flow line of, say, fluid particle, that's true. But you cannot apply it automatically to different streamlines. And in this case, there is a streamline coming above the ball and then streamline below the ball. But these are different streamlines. You can't apply Bernoulli to both at the same time. You can't say, well, this streamline, they have the same kind of constant. No, it's not implied in the theorem. There is another version of Bernoulli, which is called a time-dependent Bernoulli, for potential flow, which means that if there's no vortex in the system, you can apply Bernoulli to the entire fluid region. But in this case, there's a lot of vortex. You saw the whole thing spinning. So you cannot apply Bernoulli there either. So it's actually a non-application. You can't use Bernoulli to explain this. So what is happening is the question. What is really happening has to do with something that is subtle, but in some sense even more primitive than Bernoulli. You see, when we do this, the air is streaming above the ball and is being deflected along the ball like this. Why does it deflect? Because the air has to stick to the ball. Fluid is a continuum. It doesn't want to sort of snap out and create a vacuum. So if there is a solid boundary, for example, some body like this, it wants to go along the boundary of this thing. And that's why it gets deflected. And underneath, it kind of goes like that also. So the long and short of it is that the whole airflow comes in like this, but goes out like this. So it curved. But whenever the trajectory of a moving object curves, for example, fluid curves, there must be a force that's curving it. Yeah? And that force is being supplied by the ball. because ball is leading the fluid around this, because the fluid wants to cohere, that's the technical term, and wants to go around the ball. Well, action and reaction. If nature has produced one effect, it has to pay for it by having the counter effect, and the reaction is from the fluid, the surrounding fluid, air, to the ball. And if the ball has supplied this kind of force in order to deflect the airflow, the air has to supply the counter force in order to lift the ball. So whenever there is a curvature of the flow line, that creates what we call the pressure gradient. If it's curving like this, the inner part has high pressure and the outer part has low pressure. And mathematically speaking, it's really related with the centrifugal force. So centrifugal force for speed v is like v squared over r. R is the sort of radius of this curvature, and that's actually the pressure gradient that you're creating. So the again, long and short of it is that because you have a high pressure region, low pressure region, it's going to be lifted upward. The ball is providing this deflecting, a curving trajectory. So the ambient fluid has to apply a force which compensates for that, which is in this direction. And this is really an effect of a curving trajectory of any kind. So if you have a curving trajectory, for example, the radius of this curvature is r, and it's going at the speed v, and it's going around, it turns out that there's a centrifugal force which is like this, and let's say rho is the density, and this is the pressure gradient, which increases as you go from in to out. That's what the Neyman sign is.
So, Professor, the ball,
yes,
turned the air around the corner. Like it made the air change direction.
Yes.
So the air gets its revenge in a way, doesn't it?
Yeah, that's right.
If you're going to do that, then I'm going to push you in the opposite direction.
Ah, that's a very good language.
But for the air to get its revenge, it has to touch the ball. Like it has to be able to punch it.
That's right.
Where is the air punching the ball? Is it from underneath? Or
yes.
Because it can't pull it, can it? Because it hasn't got hooks or anything that it can pull with.
Well, it can pull because, you see, if you have air next to the ball and the air leaves the ball, well, if it can just freely leave the ball, it's going to leave a vacuum behind. But the fact of the matter is the fluid next to the solid doesn't want to create a vacuum, it doesn't want to cavitate, it wants to sort of cohere, it wants to fill the whole space with some substance. So when it's pulling away, by that very effect, it's actually pulling the solid as well. And on the molecular level, it's clear what's happening. You know, molecules are all attracting each other. All the air molecules are kind of connected by spring to neighboring region. And when you pull the spring, that spring, you know, shrinks and then pulls the whole thing in. And similarly, if you push, the springs get compressed, and that's what the pressure is.
So, Professor, as a mathematician and a physicist, when you're sitting on a plane flying to Japan and you look out the window and you see the wing, in your head, are you imagining the wing being pulled up by the air or pushed up by the air?
I think it's both. You see, the wind is so designed that, roughly speaking, the air comes in like this. Air comes in like this and goes out like that. So its current is, the trajectory is deflected. And that creates two effects, both of which are conspiring, of course, that the air underneath is pushing upward and the air above is pulling. That's a figurative way of speaking, but essentially, again, what's going on is that there's a pressure difference, and you have an effect from high pressure region to low pressure region, you are pushing against each other. By the way, pressure is, everyone knows, is force divided by area. If you multiply top and bottom, numerator and denominator, by length, you get force times length, that's called work, that's a form of energy, and area times length, that's volume. So it's actually energy per volume. Pressure is like potential energy per volume, and we're saying that if you have a high pressure region, that's high potential energy region, and low potential energy region, which is low pressure region, then the stuff moves, is pushed from high pressure to low pressure, which is exactly the same thing as if you have, a slope like this, hill and a valley. Well, the ball wants to roll from high potential region to the low potential region, just rolls down, and gains some kinetic energy by doing this. So the pressure is acting like the potential energy. Let's do the spoon, actually. So let's go. Yeah, let's do the spoon, because I like your language of the taking revenge. Yeah, that's great. That's wonderful. So you can do another home experiment to see that whenever a fluid flow curves the trajectory of the fluid curves, it creates a pressure gradient, difference in pressure, which sucks something in on one side and pushes something out on the other side. As soon as the spoon touches the water gets deflected, you see, from straight vertical down to the side. And that has the effect of pulling the spoon in. Do you see that? Poof. And that's because if the water momentum is changed from this to this, that means that somebody must be providing a force from left to right, and the counterforce is applied to the spoon from right to left, and that sucks in the spoon from this side. And if I touch the spoon, the water with the spoon from this side, it's the opposite effect. Yeah, and that's essentially like that, you know, levitating ball, but the picture is seen sideways. You see, the airflow was coming in like this and going out like this. And if you turn it by 90 degrees, it's exactly the same picture. Yeah. And this is the ball, which is sucked in the direction opposite to the direction of deviation of the fluid flow. You see, there's a cup here, and the challenge is to just tuck the ball up and then put it in the cup. Now, that's, of course, very, very difficult to do. So you shouldn't do this in public, because the chances of success are very small.